Sorry, I have a quick question.
No,
so I made way too many of the wrong things on stage.
Okay.
How do I do it? Does it even matter if they're there?
It doesn't really matter if they're there. Okay. I am kind of curious how you made them there.
I didn't know how to edit ones that were already existing because I uploaded the wrong thing.
So supposedly the easiest way to do that is you're from your machine working in editing and pushing up to your GitHub repository, and then from your GitHub repository you just say git pull, and that pulls the latest changes. You should never actually have to create more things like that. In the end, if you have one that works and that's the one you want to send me, just send me the link to that one and the link to the GitHub repository that generated it.
On my GitHub, is this automatically updating, or do I have to
Nothing at all gets updated here unless you push it to GitHub. So this is the process of going git add, git commit, git push, and that pushes up to GitHub. And then from here, you should be saying git clone and that GitHub string, and then git pull. And every time you make a change, you say git pull from within that directory, and it pulls things back down.
Because when I tried to do that within the same GitHub file, and I would go git clone to get it into this, it was just saying there's already a thing.
Yeah, you only clone the first time. Okay. After that, you just do a git pull.
Just a pull? Okay.
Yep, no worries.
I've done the code, I've done my CSS, I've tested it out.
You've got a few more steps. You're way, way behind, actually. You need to now move this into individual files, JS, HTML, and CSS files, and then create a GitHub repository. Push them all up into that GitHub repository, pull them down and clone onto your web server. And then finally, you have a web server link to point to. We're not going to get this done in the next 2 minutes. I'm actually a minute late to starting. You can take at the next break. We can talk about it.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, how are you?
Good. Yeah, it's better. Excellent. Good. It's nastiness going around, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, shall we launch into things? Launch? Oh, you're going to have a hard time doing anything useful on the iPad today, I'm afraid.
Yeah.
But we're recording, and feel free to follow along and then catch up afterwards. Oh, gotcha. Okay. Rats. Sorry. Okay. Great. So, but got a bunch of things going tonight. We're going to start with a little bit of a review on the homework, and some folks are having problems with pieces of the homework, and I want to just cover some bits and pieces that were going on there. Secondly, we're going to talk a little bit more about CSS and kind of making pretty web pages, using some frameworks to help with that. You guys have all tried kind of manual CSS now, and honestly, it's kind of a pain in the butt. I use it a lot, of course, but there are frameworks that make that a whole lot easier. You don't have to do as much manual stuff, and so we'll talk about those. And then we're going to launch into JavaScript, and JavaScript is huge. We're only going to keep kind of scratching the surface. I kind of take learning a computer language, particularly your first computer language, like learning a human language. And all of us have been talking English for years in various contexts. We know English like the back of our hand. We just kind of naturally do it. That is not at all the way with computer languages. Until you have just years of familiarity with it, it's going to feel artificial. It's going to feel abnormal. And the way of making it feel less so is just to look at a lot of code. And so we'll look through a lot of code examples today. And I'll kind of step through and explain how they work and explain what they are. Okay? And I don't necessarily, as I step through these examples, expect you to remember all of the individual keywords, not all the individual commands. I just want you to kind of get a feel and conceptually of what's going on in here and form enough of a memory of, okay, here are the help sources to go to. When I can't remember how to format a date, here's the page I go to for help. When I want to know what math functions to use, here's the list of the math functions I have. And so it's not that you have to memorize things through this. You just have to know where they are. And the more you use them, you memorize the ones you keep using. Yeah. And it's never going to feel natural by the end of this class. I mean, we're still going to be at the point at the end of this course that you have to look things up a whole lot. And that's just fine. In a new language, I also look things up a whole lot. It slows you down. But if you get to the idea of conceptually knowing what things it is you're supposed to be looking up, really the language you're working in matters less and less. Let's start, though, with the homework stuff in here. So there were a few new pieces in this homework. The big one was getting stuff up onto the server. It's kind of a show of hands of who felt stuck on that step as they were get a bunch of hands, okay, number of hands, so-so. This is a new big piece. I guess conceptually the thing I want to kind of reiterate on that one is that when you have terminal windows open, and I usually run with two or three or four terminal windows open on my machine, those terminal windows are pointing to different places. And so the terminal window that I open immediately on my machine is on my local machine, and I work with files there. And then I open a terminal window on the web server, and that terminal window is just on the web server. So you can think of these terminal windows that you have as basically being little portals, the screens of those machines. And I've got a screen of my machine here and a screen of the web server that I'm working on. And you have to think about what you're doing on which machine at which point in time. I could have had you just copy files up to the web server. A lot of people do manage their web servers by manually copying files up, copying files down. And it's not a horrible way to go. If you really know what's up there and you're keeping track of what you're doing and know it very well, you can do it this way. I have a couple of older web servers that are just kind of organically grown and don't have a good Git repository, and I inherited them from somebody, and I manage them fully by copying things back and forth. But it's really dangerous. The reason it's dangerous is that, let's say that web server, something happens to it, I don't know, you forget to pay your bill with DigitalOcean, and DigitalOcean cuts the plug, and they kill your web server. To recreate that, you've got to move all the files manually and know everything that was going on there to recreate it. And so instead, the way that I'm suggesting that you guys work, or actually kind of enforcing that you guys work, is to use the GitHub repository as an intermediary. So the GitHub repository is where all your code gets stored, and that's what you're pulling down to the server. It's what's known as a repeatable build process. And as we go on and look at more kind of active frameworks later, there's actually going to be a build step that's part of this. So you have files that have to run on the server before your web server is ready. But right now, it's really just to do the copy for you. Again, this process was to work on your local machine, you edit your web page, push that to repository, so git add, git commit, git push, that pushes up to the repository. Now GitHub knows the state of your web page, just the same way it was in your machine. And then you pull back down to the web server, or git clone, and then git pull back down to the web server. And it's an awful lot of steps just to copy a file to a web server, but it's an awful lot of steps that provide some rigor and source code control, so it's always in a reproducible state when you want it to be there. If you are having issues with some of these, a bunch of folks sent me an email and asked me, and I was happy to give a couple of extensions on things, and happy to talk before class with folks. I want to just reinforce and make sure that y'all know, come to me early or let me know when you're having problems and get these things fixed. This isn't like a physics class where I hand a bunch of physics problems out. If you came to me and asked, how do I do problem number four on the homework, I'd probably say, well, go read your book and do problem number four on the homework. This really isn't that kind of class. This stuff, I want you to be able to do this stuff and come to me and ask questions, and we'll get it done. But do so early. The earlier you do so, the better we can meet the deadlines on things. The other piece that was new in this week's homework, so that I kind of covered the first two on here, getting onto the server and using git clone to move your website. The other piece that was new in this week was integrating HTML, CSS, and JS files onto a single page. And we looked at this in JS Fiddle. In JS Fiddle, it's a little bit different than on individual web pages. And so here's where you're using that that link rel and the style sheet name or the script tag and then linking off to the script file. Did folks find that one it worked okay? Were you able to integrate JS files and CSS files? Nope. Okay. Let's actually then take a bit of a pass on reviewing a bit of this stuff and I'll concoct an example to look at. Let me find a place to start for an example. Sure, let's use this as our example. Whoops. Ignore some of the content of this page in that we'll get to the bootstrap stuff here in a minute. I just wanted to have something that would illustrate what we're doing in the process. If it, in fact, decides to load someday. Here we go. Okay. Okay, so ignore the content. This is a button. The button doesn't really do anything, but it's a danger button. I guess we need to give it a little bit of JavaScript just so we have a JavaScript bit in there to do something. We probably ought to, I guess, give it a little bit of CSS so that we have something to play with on the CSS. Let me just make my, it's already styled for that. So let me kill the styling and call this just button one. If I run this now, all my styling is going to be gone. My danger button's only kind of a button. That's okay. Let me in the CSS turn that so this is by class. How do I target a class? Yeah. So I'll say dot button one, then I'll give this, let's just say color green. Just for a silly bit of CSS styling in this. And we have a green danger link there now. So in JS Fiddle, and also just to prove that we have something running, when I hit F12 in here, it's going to open my dev console, and my console log says hi. I've got both JS and CSS running in here now. Just to remind you how I always start a project, so I might play in JS Fiddle a little bit, before I actually do anything useful in separating this out into files, I'm going to create a repository for it. Let's go ahead and start a project in GitHub. We're going to call this, a silly example. And I'm not going to give it a description, but I am going to initialize it with a README. And I'll create this repository. And then I'm going to copy my clone link over here. And then I better open a terminal window. Or git bash window, actually. Oops. Except, of course, my git bash window will come on the wrong screen. I'm going to cd into untangling. Let's see what else is there. I just have a test repo right now. And so I'm going to git clone my link. Cloning into silly example. I'll cd into silly example. I'll look, and I've just got a README, so nothing else in here. Great. Then the next thing I usually do in editing this stuff is I'm just going to open a Visual Studio Code window. I do that, of course, for everything in the directory with this code period. And of course, it's going to open that on the wrong screen as well. Take a minute to open that guy up. And of course, there's very little in this right now. I'm going to create a new file in Silly Example that is my index.html. It can be named anything here, of course. Screen, I can read a little bit more easily. It can be named anything, but index.html is special. If you call something index.html, then you don't actually have to type the HTML name when you're in the browser. But if you just type the name of the repository, it'll go to that one and load that one first. So often you'll see things called index.html when they're the page that's supposed to be loaded first on the web page. That's why you see that that format. And then let's go back to over here back into my JS Fiddle. I want to start moving things over. So let's take the contents of my HTML page copy that. We'll come back to here and paste that. And of course, there are a couple things missing from this that because it's not putting them in JS Fiddle, or it's putting them in automatically. We've got a doc type HTML that can be in there. That's kind of optional. We've got the HTML tag itself that's in there. That's a little bit less optional. And we'll go ahead and close that HTML tag. Then in an ideal world, we would also have a head, which right now we won't really have anything in, but hey, what if close the head rather than opening the head? Got a head, and we'll close the head. And then we've got a body. And down here at the bottom of this, we'll close the body. I'm going to take a minute to clean up on things here just a little bit get some of my tabs working properly get it to be a little bit more readable code. One of the nice things about Visual Studio Code is I can group select, and so I'll give everything that's inside body two tabs, then I'll go hit body and give it a tab. I'll move my head head close in one as well. So that's a pretty reasonable little start of an HTML page. Let's save that. Just to make sure that things are working at this point, I would probably go ahead and find my way into my directory and run that. So let's do that. Let me navigate where that directory is. Oh, you can't see what I'm doing. Sorry, I'll move this over. I just opened a file browser to where that directory is, and I might want to look at it, which of course also doesn't show up there. Let's instead pull that up in Chrome. There we go. So I've got a single button on there. This button has no JavaScript yet. If I open up my code browser here, I don't say a hi there. So there's nothing being logged console log. There is nothing styling this. This is still a blue danger link and not a green danger link. So let's go fix that now. The next thing I'm going to do in here is go ahead and create another file. I'm going to create an index.css, and let me also create an index.js. Now, you don't have to name your CSS files and your JS files the same as the name of the HTML file, but I often do, primarily just because it makes me keep track better of what files correspond with what in there. Let's do the index.js first, just because it's simple. I'll say console.log hi, save that. And then I have to tell the HTML file how to link that up with the other one. And I'm going to make this just in the head. So there are three places that you can put JS files. In the head, in the body, or on load. The order of things is on load, first it gets run, then the head files get run, then the body files get run. And it's important if you have to pre-instantiate some things to know about those three places. In a couple things during the later part of the lecture today, there will be specific times when I'm asking you to load in the body versus in the head. So just keep in mind that there are multiple places you can load JS files. Yep. And onload. Yep. So at the time the page is loading, before anything else goes, if you have to load any objects in that the head files react to, then that's where you do that. Yeah. It's primarily head and body we'll have to think about today anyways. Okay, so I'm going to load this one in the head, which means I want to use a script tag. And in the script, let's actually pop back out to here. And if I didn't really remember how to set up a script tag, Google is your friend. If you just say HTML script tag, you will almost immediately get brought to a million sites that describe that. I really like W3 Schools. It's one of the more reliable sources. There's also the MSDN network, or MDN network, Mozilla Developer Network, which are pretty good. But those two are the two places that I go to remind myself of things. And of course, what this is immediately saying is that you can put script in line using the script tag. That's not really what we're after here. We're trying to link out to another script file. So I might pop my way back out and go to the other resource, MDN, Mozilla Developer Network, and it might give me a more complete listing of what I can put into here. And so here's what I'm looking for, that source. That's the main thing that I need in the script tag right now, if I'm going to have it referencing another file, is this source attribute. Great. So if I say script source equals index.js, and then I need to actually close that, and I can close it itself, but it's better form to actually put in a closing tag. So let's save this. Let's pop back over to our web page here, hit refresh. Hi, great. So my JS is being called. Is that all clear on how I'm calling JavaScript from inside my web page? Go back in here. Yep, exactly. So that gets the first part. Let's now talk about how we did the second piece to integrate the CSS from the JS fiddle that we were working on. Pretty similar process, but we actually use a different command other than script to get it in. So here we were. So I was just taking button and I was coloring it green. So I'll copy my CSS. I'll come back to here. I'd created my CSS. I'm going to paste that in here. I'm going to save that. And it's not going to know how to find that yet. If I went straight to my screen over here and refreshed, it's going to stay blue because I haven't told it where the CSS is. Here's another thing. We could search for this again just to show you how I would do that if I'd forgotten. Instead of HTML script tag, I'm going to search for a link tag. If I didn't actually know how to search for a link tag, I might search for something like HTML call CSS or something. And somewhere in here, you're going to find a page either in the CSS how-to this one I bet would work as well. We're going to find one of these pages that tells you how it is that you integrate that. And I'm looking for not the inline CSS, not the internal CSS, but the external. So here it is, a link rel style sheet. And they have that put in the head. Let's pop back over, pop to my HTML. I'm going to put that right afterwards. Get my indenting right just because I'm being a stickler today. And then it's not styles.css. I called it index.css in my case. FLS. I'll pop back over. I'll refresh this. Okay, great. It's green now. So I've got my CSS being called from my HTML page. Everybody with me so far? Yep. Perfect. So it's all working on my machine now, but it's not working anywhere else. Remember the first steps that I did when I was on my machine inside my terminal window? is I had done the git clone to that new repository that I had created. In that repository now, I can get a list of the files that are there, and you'll see all four of the files, the README and the three files I just edited are in there. And if I do a git status, I see that there are three untracked files. The HTML, the CSS, and the JS are all in there, but they're not being tracked. And so here's where I'm going to do my git add and period. That period means add all the files. If I only wanted to add two of the files, I could say git add index.css and git add index.js. And then I would see that index.html is untracked. But in this case, I wanted all of them to be tracked. And so git add period is just a shortcut to doing that. So now if I git status, remember I can up arrow to go back to anything I've typed before, I see that everything is tracked and the changes are ready to be committed. Now I want to do a git commit and give myself a good commit message. So the first files in my silly example. And it commits those. Let me show git status again. I'm showing that I'm ahead of origin master by one commit. And so since I'm ahead of origin master, I can just push myself up to origin master. And git push knows where to go. And boom, it pushes my changes up there. If I do a git status again, it'll show that I'm up to date with origin master. Nothing to commit, working tree clean. So everything that I had on my machine when I was doing these edits is now sitting up in the GitHub server. The GitHub repository, if I look back at that here, it's going to, on a refresh, show me all those files, the first files in my silly example. But nothing is actually over on my server yet. So I'm going to get that to happen next. I've actually, to save me typing my username and password all the time, I've been using this program called Kitty, which Kitty is a SSH client. I had a page in last week's notes on how to do that. But you could just type SSH, your dev number at the IP address and type your password manually each time. I just find it's easier to go ahead and use this password manager so that I don't have to do that every time. Whether you type it in a terminal window or you use Kitty or a SSH client like that, you end up right here on the root of the web server. So on the web server now, I see that there's only one directory. It's that public HTML. Everything I do is inside that right now. I've got this test repo, but I don't have my new silly example here. And so here is where I will do a git clone. Oops, I guess I copied things after I copied my silly example link. So I'll go back and copy my silly example link again. See, go, and it's going to clone into silly example, now it's there. If I ls, it's in there, if I were to go look at cspubble.uvic.ca dev00 my silly example, then it's not going to work. Why is it not going to work? Did I type something wrong? Oh, it's just a silly example, not my silly example. Okay. There we go. So my green button is up there. And so that's the whole process in a nutshell. When I want to work on something new, I'll start playing around in the fiddle. Move it to files on my local machine. I'll create my repo on GitHub, push up to my repo on GitHub, and then pull back down to the web server. Perfect. Yeah, let me show you that step as well, just so that everybody's clear on that. This was the first time through, but you never do things just once and have it be perfect. Let's say that I wanted to really wanted to change this to red rather than green. It's silly to have danger written in green. It makes things people think everything's okay. I'd go in and hit my CSS in here. I'll change my CSS to red. All different flavors of red. I like the fact that Visual Studio Code lets me look at the colors I'm doing. Alternate medium violet red. There we go. I save that. I go back to my local terminal window and see if Git has picked that up. And sure enough, it has. Git modified index.css. So I'll say git add dot git commit minus m changed color. Git push. Push that up. And then I'll go here to this guy, go into silly example, and say git pull. And it will pull that down. And I go here and refresh, and I'm red. So that's the process of making edits, just to work locally, push them up, and then do a git pull to pull those back down to your repository. Everybody happy? Someone? Okay. Cool. Well, I'll keep repeating it every time someone gets stuck, and hopefully it gets in here and sticks. That's kind of the piece that is some people are getting stuck on this homework. Web servers are hard. That's just one way of communicating with them. It's a really kind of rigorously, provably correct way of doing so, because then things are always in the known state in sync with your machine. Let's do that. Let's step away from Bootstrap because I haven't gotten there yet. Right. Okay. I think we hit the other things in the old stuff revisited here as well. So I think I've talked about most of the pieces on this. Now I know a couple of people are having some Flexbox issues, a couple of people are having some formatting issues, and they're kind of individual issues we can hit individually. But anybody else have broad problems that came out in this homework that they want to talk about as a group? Okay. I'm going to keep flying on then, we'll talk about some of today's topics. The main thing I wanted to hit first today was UI frameworks. There's a lot of different types of UI frameworks. I'm doing a lot of work these days in a framework called React. React and Angular some of these things like Vue.js are frameworks that encompass a lot more than just visuals. So they aren't just styling frameworks. They're part of what's called an MVC or a Model View Controller framework for web development. This model view controller is a way of thinking about reasoning on websites and having your view, the piece that's displayed to the user, just be part of this larger architecture and moving of data around to make your website work. I'm not talking about that type of framework today. Later in the course, we'll talk a little bit about these, and we'll talk about some of the architecting of the data flow in your websites. But today, when I say UI framework, I'm really just talking about ways of doing styling in easier to manage packages than individually and doing each tag that you want to style. Now, in CSS directly, you can do some of this by selecting on classes or selecting on the tag you want to style. But it's really very limited, and you've got to think about the color of everything. And if you want to change things all in one fell swoop, you really can't do it very well. We're going to talk about two styling frameworks in particular today, Bootstrap, which was developed by Twitter, and then UIKit. I really prefer UIKit at this point, but it's also a little bit more complicated to get into than Bootstrap. So I'm going to suggest that for the most part, you guys use Bootstrap as a starting point, and then go to UIKit if you're finding Bootstrap too limited and you want to do things beyond what it can do. But play with Bootstrap first of these. They're a little bit different development styles. There's a little bit getting used to between the two, but not that different. So you can certainly hop between them as you want. So Twitter originally developed a Bootstrap. It's sometimes called Twitter Bootstrap, in fact. Then they open sourced it. So there are probably 1,000 different varieties of Bootstrap out there right now. And you can make your own variety. Because it is open source, you can just go to the GitHub repository for Bootstrap. Pull the CSS files down, change them the way you want, then keep your own private copy of that somewhere. This is what's called forking on GitHub, by the way. If you see the buttons at the top on anybody else's GitHub repository, you'll always have an option to fork. And that fork means take a copy of this person's GitHub repository, move it into my repository, and let me keep editing on it and call it my own. And this is really useful if you somebody have somebody else that's gotten part of the way to what you want to do, but you want to modify it, but don't want to modify it in a way that pushes back to a common project where they take all of your changes. Thousands of people have forked Bootstrap at this point, made their own modifications to it, made it act in the way that they want it. One of the things I'm just going to mention right now, although not focus on it, is that Bootstrap also uses a component called jQuery. jQuery is a package that sits on top of HTML to make working with the document object model easier. It says it's a small fast. I put a link from jQuery.com in there. In actuality, it's kind of grown and ballooned, and everything with the kitchen sink is in there now. So if you're designing really fast, responsive sites for mobile, for instance, jQuery is one of those things you try and work around and not necessarily have to have on your web page. Just kind of treat it as a dependency right now. Know that it has to be there. If things are looking right but not working right, the most likely thing is that you've forgotten to include jQuery somewhere. Most functions, though, in Bootstrap are just CSS, so they're just styling. Again, down to this distinction that the CSS is the way pages look, the JS is the way pages act, and the HTML are the object that things act upon. And so you have to provide all the HTML. That's your responsibility in any case, because that's what the page gets laid out as. Bootstrap provides the CSS for that, so that by giving class names, you are able to tell it what type of styling to apply. So for instance, in this one, and this is the example I just showed a minute ago, this href, I'm giving a class of button and button danger. This pound sign in the href is really just saying go to the current page. So kind of ignore it. The href is a necessary element of an anchor tag, but if you don't want it to do anything except for fire some JavaScript, then what you're going to do is just hold a pound in there for the href rather than going to a different page. And so this is going to look like a button, believe it or not, even though it looks like an anchor tag. Let's start from this example I showed just a minute ago. Let me walk through this, and then I'm going to have you guys do a bit of an exercise and try and get some other buttons on here. So I'm going to run this, you can see that I've got a title that says buttons. So that's what shows up here, the first heading. That one comes from here. But the first heading says buttons. And then I've got a div, and inside that div, I've got this anchor tag with an href pointing to the current page. And I'm giving a class of button, and then another class of button danger. And then I'm giving the text danger. If I change the text here, of course, the name on the button changes. If I change the class that is on the button, if I get rid of the first button, it's going to probably not look like a button anymore. Yep, it looks like a link. Put that first button back. It looks like a button again. So these classes are things that the Twitter Bootstrap styling has built-in definitions for. And if I were to use a different type of button other than button danger, it would look like a different type of button. And so that's what we're going to do next here, actually, is I'm going to have you guys do a bit of an exercise and create me a page that has a default button, a primary button, a success button, an info button, a warning button, and a danger button. And you can just use the page that I pulled up at this link as the starting point example to do that. Take just a couple minutes. Well, I guess I said on here, note the external resources, but don't really worry about it right now. As long as you start from that example link, then you'll have the resources already included for you.
We'll talk about styling.
Cool. So pretty easy, yeah? It's not actually. Here's where I said notice the external resources required. In JS Fiddle, we've got this area over here for external resources. And I've actually pasted in Bootstrap min.js and Bootstrap min.css and jQuery.min.js. And so these are the files that create these presets basically to look for these classes. And if I didn't have those in there, then it wouldn't actually look like Bootstrap anymore. I keep clicking on the wrong screen and it keeps going in the wrong place. And now Microsoft PowerPoint has stopped working. Yay, Microsoft. Sorry, let me get my screen back here. I'm working on that. Not working on that. Okay. I won't bother going to the answer because we all just got the same answer. So the next one here is I have another example here that I want you to take some more Bootstrap classes on. Let me click on this one, show you what it starts out as, and I've just shown you the reference link to Bootstrap there. In this example, I basically have a Jumbotron area, which is this big gray part up here, and then some columns. And the thing about the columns, and you were just asking me this organization question, is that a responsive UI is one that, given the space it has available, will lay out appropriately for that space. And I think in this one, I may not actually be able to have enough space because my screen resolution is so weird up here. On your screen where you have better screen resolution, I bet you're able to stretch this out enough so that it pops into multiple columns. And that's where this definition in the code here is able to get more space back on that side. Is able to say that I want columns small four wide to be the column definition that I'm using for this page. The other thing that I've got in here, and we'll talk about this in just a moment as well, is this optional themed version of Bootstrap in here. So this is what I mean about changing things really quickly if you have Bootstrap, is that if I wanted this to be a dark theme to preserve my night vision, then I could theme that using darkly rather than readable, and my whole page will go into this dark theme, and it changes all of my stylings at once. And so that's the real advantage of Bootstrap, is that you can play with styling your page after you get the logical elements built up out on the page. So I want to have you do something on this page. I want you to take a minute to put a hover tip. This is a tool tip, is what it's called. So when I hover over this, it says hooray, or it says whatever else you want it to be. And so in order to do that, you're going to look at this Bootstrap reference and find the tool tip and then put that into your code. And you get done with hover, play around with some of the other stuff that's in there as well, kind of get a feel for the So that same concept is copying the pieces of that data file on the title will also work for different data. Everybody ready to move on?
No? Okay.
If you're talking about that, it's possible.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah. First,
Gotcha, yeah. But the way the toolkit work is from your message, just sweeping over something cool that doesn't pop up with your page. So, if your name update is class, that would be fine. No, any element can be given a class name. The reason is just to spell gray in the box that you have to get bootstrapped right. And so, if you took out that class, then the rest would still work. But you should be sort of doing things a little bit better.
I am. Yep. So I could put this on any element that I wanted in here. In this case, I just put it on the div, so if I hover over the div and hang out there, it's going to say hooray. And that's being done by this data toggle tooltip and this title hooray, which carries the content of the tooltip. Basically, this is another thing about Bootstrap. Anything that is in a data toggle, it tends to be an active piece that's calling JavaScript. It's saying use this data to do something. And anything that is just in a class is a passive styling to calling CSS in. And so I wouldn't be able to do this tooltip if I didn't have the JavaScript or the jQuery rather pulled in for an external resource. And if I pull this out and run this, my guess is that this dies horribly. Oh, it doesn't die horribly. Huh. Most data toggles will die horribly without jQuery in there. I guess for some reason this doesn't, I'll turn red and see that doesn't work. Cool. So if I wanted this somewhere else, then of course I could put it on any element that I wanted in here. These are just basically decorators to the element. If I wanted my first column here to have some of that stuff, I could probably decorate that header for it. Let's run that, and then that should say hooray, but nothing else around there. So get the idea of how I can attach some behaviors out of Bootstrap to other elements on a page? Cool. The other thing in here is Bootstrap themes, and I already showed an example of this to restyle to that Darkly theme. There are a couple places of, actually a bunch of places to get Bootstrap themes. I really like Bootswatch. It just happens to have a whole bunch of really good free themes. I tend to find that I don't have to go beyond the free themes very much. Just again to that example, I'm pulling in the CSS for Bootstrap explicitly over here in my CSS file. Now, this actually duplicates the external resources call of that. You can see that this bootstrap.min.css is named exactly the same as my external resources that come from NetDNA CDN. And the last one loaded is going to win in any CSS file. So if you have a CSS file of your own that redefines just one class in Bootstrap, and you load that class after Bootstrap, so you load it in your CSS, then that Bootstrap class is going to be overridden. This is important because it means that you don't have to replace the entirety of Bootstrap to change just the way that that one thing works. So it also means that if I wanted to, let's say, put in a .jumbotron definition here and redefine the color of Jumbotron as green, then hopefully this is able to, there we go. This is able to override the Bootstrap classes. This is really important because it means that you still have full control over your page in the places that you want to have full control of your page. You're just using Bootstrap as a convenience to style things all at once. Now, it also means that if I were to not use the Darkly theme, but instead use the, if I went to that Boots Watch page, I could tell that there was a Cerulean theme, then it's going to change things. And my other heading is going to be blue, but the one I explicitly called green is going to stay green. And so when you explicitly override things in Bootstrap, you don't keep the full effect of the styling, and you're going to have these funny clashes of green and blue where you wouldn't expect them to appear and would be bad from a design perspective. So override as little as possible, but when you do have something that you want to override, know that you can't do so just by putting your definitions in last after any files that you pull in. Templates are another thing. I might as well show the templates page just so you know it's there. I really hate starting to code from scratch. I do so a lot in here just because it kind of describes what the simplest version of a web page and stuff is. But when I'm building a page for a client one of my own projects or something, I always start with something else that I've done, or I grab something from one of these templates and start from that. It's just easier not to have to do all the setup for things yourself a lot of the times. And these templates are a great place to start in terms of just having something to use as a starting point to see how things look. And I may not stay with that. I may copy the pieces I want out into my project if I want it organized differently or something. But one of the great things about Bootstrap is that it has such a wealth of developers on it that you can find examples. Some of these are paid. Some of these are free. There's really very little reason to go to the paid ones unless it just does precisely what you want it to do and you don't have to do any more coding. But when you download these, you actually will find that there's a whole bunch of help on how to do that. And it also often is actually on GitHub itself. So if I click the view source in any of these, it's going to point me to the GitHub site where it's all defined. And so if I just want to know a little bit about, how the CSS is styled for that page and what their overrides are, then that's what I can drill into to see what their definitions are. And probably too detailed to want to look at here, of course. But one of the nice things about the Bootstrap ecosystem is it is mostly an open source ecosystem. And if you want to modify things and see how people are doing certain effects, you can dig on in and find out how they're doing that. Any more questions about Bootstrap? Okay. It's about 7 o'clock. Let's take a few minute break and then come back and talk about UIKit instead of just launching directly into it. So see you back in about five or 7 minutes. Yeah. Thank you.
But you tried it before that as well when you're working instead of looking for okay. So for some reason, the bootstrap that was loaded in there was not loaded in the because two bootstraps don't be loaded. Anyways, that's the new version.
Yeah, okay.
So,
yeah. You just covered this.
Okay.
You just covered this.
Mm-hmm.
We did. So I'm going to let you tell me a little bit what you do next.
So what I think is that we should have to do.
Mm-hmm. Kind of, yeah. So show me the directory that this is sitting in on your local machine. Okay, it shouldn't be. It should be in the GitHub directory. Remember how we went through that process of creating a new repository on GitHub? And that created a directory on my local machine when I said git clone?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, have you created a repository on GitHub for this yet?
I have.
Yeah, okay, great. Can you find me the clone path from that?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. And zip on over to that side. Are you on that far side? There should be a git. Okay. It looks funny. Yeah. I can grab the mine, but copy that.
Copy this picture.
Yeah, copy the whole thing. And then go to your command window and the machine. Okay. And have you created an untangling directory yet?
No.
Okay, go to mkdir. Space untangling. And then enter and then cd untangling. Tab will always complete what you're talking about. If you just type U tab, then it will complete it. It's just going to check that. You have Mr. G at the end. And do an ls, make sure there's nothing in there. Okay. And now say git clone and then paste that string you just copied. And space. And paste that string you just copied. Okay. Okay. So you now do an ls. Make sure you have something in there. Yep, you do. Perfect. Then you can copy into that directory all the files that you've been working on. Because that's where they should live instead of in any other file on the computer. That's where you want them to be.
So we're going to find this file?
If you CD into that, you need to get to where you're CDing. CDs change directory, so it never knows where you're changing to unless you you always type tab to complete. And so if you type tab, then you have. Do an LS? Your CD moved you back to the home directory. You'll have to CD back in Dungeon. You never have to type the whole word. CD into CSC, but just type CD space. C capital, then hit tab. And it completes for you. So you don't have to keep typing. This is what I kept saying. Okay, hit enter. And now say PWD for present working directory.
Yep.
No, present working directory. So that's the directory that this stuff should be in. Mm-hmm. And now if you want to copy to a Finder, you can go to Finder and copy into that path. And it's an empty directory, so I guess we don't expect to necessarily see it, but I would expect to see it. I don't like Mac Finder very much. Mac Finder is actually quite annoying. Can you search for untangling? Will the untangling directory come up? There we go. Yep, okay. So now copy the files you were working on into that directory.
The whole thing?
Yeah. Just the files rather than the directories. But, okay, sure. And do these not have file extensions, or are you just not showing the file extensions? If you go back over here and type LS, what's it say? Okay, they don't have file extensions. They need to have. You need to, if this is your HTML page, it has to have a .html extension. If this is your CSS, it has to have a .css extension. Okay. So now over here, let's say git status.
Yes, indeed.
Status. No, just menu. Just yes. Okay. So it's telling me that these files are not tracked. And so see, it says git add file, or here you can say git add period. Whenever you say git add, it's a command, and so you have to have a space before the next article. So git space add space period. Yep. And now do a git status again. Okay, and so now you can do a commit and a push, and then you can pull down to the server, and I've got to get back to lecture.
Awesome.
Yeah, getting closer. We'll get you next break. Okay, let's launch back into UIKit. This is my favorite of the UI styling frameworks right now, but it is a little bit more complicated to get started with, and so we're not going to spend very much time on it today. The reference example here is the place to go get the information on it and stuff. Then let me have a quick look at an example from UIKit just to say that we've done so. This is a Fiddle version of it. If we wanted to look at a website that I recently did with UIKit, we could go to 3data.ca. And it just lets me do stylings that are a fair amount richer than the stylings that I can get inside of the Bootstrap themes. They just have neat behaviors and stuff that fly around, whereas Bootstrap has a little bit more limited set of behaviors. So in here, for instance, if I want a logout page, this gives me a modal behavior to log out. And what I'm doing is this is a little bit of jQuery, but a little bit of a JavaScript in here to pull up the UIKit modal, but really most of it's working exactly the same way that the stuff did in Bootstrap. I've got classes like UK button, UK icon caret down, which is that little icon that the classes are what defining the styling layout, just the same way as it was in Bootstrap in there. A few other subtle things going on. I've got drop-down menus and a little bit more JavaScript integration than I do in Bootstrap. But for the most part, you can think of it as a pure styling framework. In any case, I put this up here just kind of for completeness that there are other options. I'd encourage you to get really familiar with Bootstrap first and then go on beyond Bootstrap UI Kit and some of the others. But know that others are out there when you run out of stuff that that Bootstrap can do. We kind of just went through some of these pieces about using Bootstrap or UI Kit on your own pages rather than JS Fiddle, but I wanted to make sure it was in the notes so that when you went to try and do this on your own pages, you were able to. The instructions are on Git Bootstrap and Git UI Kit. The main thing, though, is that you have to include a link to the style sheet and a link to the script. And if you have those pieces in there, also in the case of Bootstrap, a link to jQuery, you're going to be good to go on it. And all the instructions are on that Git Bootstrap link there at the start as to what you have to put in the top of your HTML file to make all this go. So from there, I want to go into some JavaScript pieces. Everybody ready to do a little bit of JavaScript here? Cool. We're going to go through a number of exercises, all of them are going to rely on this thing that I went through last week about how to talk to your JavaScript from your HTML page, conversely, how to talk to your HTML page from your JavaScript. We're going to use inner.html or .innerHTML as the object that we talk to for JavaScript to push text up to the page that we're working on. Then we're going to talk about a couple of different ways of launching the scripts from the HTML. The most frequently used one is to use an on-click on buttons or on-hover or other actions on the objects that you're putting on your HTML page and have those called functions. And so the functions are basically what are doing all of the heavy lifting in JavaScript. I'm going to keep clicking on some of the examples through here just to show you what I mean, and that these are pretty important concepts to come back to. I also, though, I'm not going to dwell on them a lot, and the main reason I put examples in is so that when you get lost, you're working on things at home, you know what to go back to and have examples to follow. And so in this first one, I am creating a paragraph tag. I'm giving that paragraph tag an ID of para1. And I'm putting some text in there, and then I've got a button, and that button calls a function. And so this my function on click is the way that I'm calling a function from my HTML and defining what function I'm going to. I'm not passing any parameters. If I had parameters to pass in, they'd pass in inside the parentheses here. My function really isn't doing much of anything. It calls the document, and this is the HTML document, and says get element by ID para 1. And so this is the entire reason that I gave this paragraph an ID. And then it's setting the inner HTML of that paragraph to say hello. So when I click the button text, it's going to turn into hello. The document object model, or DOM, is what defines the HTML page. And each of the elements of the DOM have a variety of attributes inside those. And even have a data attribute. Anything that actually shows text on the screen that has this inner HTML. And so it's basically just the variable in the DOM element that displays what's actually put on the screen. And that actually, something that I ought to elaborate on there is I'm using text, but if I wanted to, instead of text in here, say, hello, button, and I won't make the button do anything. And close that and run it. I'm going to go back to some text, and now when I click it, I'm going to get a button in there. So it's not just that you can shove text in there, it's that you can shove any HTML object into that inner HTML, and it's going to get rendered on the page. And this is really important when you want to do a partial rendering or have some action on the page, update some other part of the page, you can basically use this to insert, inject any form of HTML onto that page if you want to. That's right, exactly. And it also is important to note that it does this without a server round trip. So that if you have client-side JavaScript, you can change the page without going back and refreshing the whole page from the server. So a couple things to remember, that when you are running most of the examples today, you want them running in the body. And let me show you in here what I mean by that. When I click on JavaScript here, I have options of load type, of running it on load, on DOM ready. So on load was when the first the page first comes up. On DOM ready is when the document object model is fully instantiated, but before any of the head or body have been executed. On head is after on DOM ready, and then on body is after anything in the head. So that's the order of load events in here. This one, I'm just running it on the body because I don't really care about setting anything up for it, and it won't actually ever be activated until the user clicks on a button. And so the user can't click on a button until everything else is rendered. So on body is the appropriate place to put this. The only reason you'll put anything other than on body is when you want things to happen early, when they're getting the page set up for other things to happen on that page. The other one is that when you get in trouble on things, make sure you remember that developer console. Developer console is gold. I use F12 as my way of getting to it. I think it's Shift Command I on the Mac. So you can always also go to the corner of your Chrome browser, go to More Tools, and go to Developer Tools. Control Shift I is the other way on the PC of getting to it. So variables and scope. This is a big, big topic, and I've got some things for you in later weeks to talk about scope. For today, you can think of any variable that you declare as being active the entire file in which it was declared. Most of things in JavaScript are called block scope, the block in this case is the file that they sit in. Now you can declare things so that they're more finely scoped, so they exist only within a function. And you can do this either accidentally or on purpose. Accidentally, you do it by giving something the same name inside a function as a variable outside the function. This is a very poor development practice because you're going to get yourself confused and not know which variable it is that you're talking about. But you can also do it explicitly if you want to have things only accessible within a particular function for some reason. By and large, though, it's going to be anything in a file is accessible to any of the functions within that file. And anything declared within a function is not going to be accessible to things outside of that function. And so they're accessible to the block that they're in and anything below that, but not back up the tree for the most part. There are some exceptions to that. We'll talk about exceptions later as we get into corner cases. In the body, you can initialize things on page load outside of a function and then use that variable within functions. Let me show an example of that. So I've got this page here, I've got that same paragraph tag, I've got the same ID, paragraph 1, I've got some text in there, I've got the button that's calling the my function. I've really changed very little about that part. The only thing that I've changed is that inside my function, I've got this count plus plus. This is a shortcut way of saying increment the count. And so when I click that button, it's going to say hello 1. Click it again, hello 2, hello 3, hello 4. I'm basically, each time I'm clicking it, incrementing that count counter and then displaying that with the HTML. So this is the first example of keeping track of actions in the UI and showing what I'm keeping track of in here. Now, I could have done this a couple of wrong ways. Let's go ahead and get me back to my sumText state. Let's say that I had not actually initialized that to 0. If I just declared the variable count and then tried to increment it each time. When I click, it's going to say count NaN. That stands for not a number. Anytime you initialize a variable, it doesn't really know what to put in that variable until you tell it what to put in that variable. If I initialize it to 0, it knows it's a number and that it should treat it as a number. If I don't initialize it to anything, it's going to be not a number. And of course, when I click the button a few more times, you can't increment not a number because it doesn't know it's a number. And so the plus plus operator just doesn't mean anything here. So I have to actually initialize that with an explicit value. If I wanted to give that a different value and start counting from 10, well, I can do that too, of course. but it has to be a number in order for count plus plus to mean anything. The other thing I could have done wrong here is I could have not known my scoping rules and thought everything had to be inside my function, in which case I try and initialize my count variable. Any idea what's going to happen on this one? It's going to be right the first time. But what about when I keep going? It's never going to change. And it's never going to change because each time I come into this function, I'm saying set count back equal to 10 and then increment it. And so logically, this means that you can't get into that function without resetting your counter variable. So this is one of those places where you really need something outside the function in order to do your initialization. And then inside the function, you do the operations you really want inside that function. All those make sense?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. If what I had in here, let's do this just to show an example of that. Let's throw another button in here and call this my function 2 and click me to 21. Okay. Then let's make a my function 2 and make it do something else. My function 2. We're not going to count in this case. We're just going to display it. Let's run this guy. Actually, it's kind of silly just to display. Okay, let's just display it. It should be 10 because that's what we set it to here. We'll count, that's 11. That's 12. Well, it doesn't change because I just displayed it. Here, let's change my function 2 to say something else. 11, 12, 13, goodbye. Because we've declared it outside of the scope, count is declared essentially globally to this entire file. Any function within that file can use it. That's a more fun way of doing it. Okay, next one. Now, we've got a bunch of built-in functions. I list this here for you guys to use as reference rather than because we're going to go through it in any great detail today. The Mozilla Developer Network is really a great resource. It's really dense and it's really hard to work through, but everything you want is in the Mozilla Developer Network resources. It talks about the types of values, infinity, not a number, undefined, null, basic objects, numbers, and dates. And so today we're going to go through some of these pieces on numbers and dates. And these are built-in objects you might want to use for various things in your programs. Let's start with dates. And this uses the console log. So I'm going to have to open my developer console in order to see what's in here. And we'll run that. And it spits out today's date and time, 7:21 and 59 seconds. 7:22 and 6 seconds. Basically, always getting the current date and time. Let's walk through the code that lets me do this as an example of using built-in objects in JavaScript here. I'm not doing anything in HTML or CSS with this. This is all just pure JavaScript. The first thing I'm doing, I'm declaring a variable today, and today gets a new date object. A date object, you can look at the definitions in here if you want as you go into this, date object is basically the top level object that lets you work with dates and times. And when I say top level object, I mean that there's a hierarchy of objects under date that let you do more granular things with dates and times. But the first step to doing anything with a date and time is to get a date object. Oops, that's where I went. Next thing I'm doing is because today is my date object, I'm going to get what day it is. That's today.getDay. I would have done that by looking here and going, what is under this What methods are here, instances. Here we go, prototype methods. I want today. All right, today equals new date. Oh, it's just day I want actually, isn't it? Get day. Returns the day of the week for the specified date according to local time where zero represents Sunday. So that would give me the day as a numerical value. And get a day list here is changing that numerical value, because remember it said with zero representing Sunday, two for Tuesday, one for Monday, so on. And so I have to give it a list of what the days are. Here's one of the areas that we'll talk later about localizing your application. And if I was trying to make something that went easily to other languages, I wouldn't put this list the way it was right here. I'd actually have string resources that I could replace for other languages. But the same concept would be there, that my code logic would be based on the numbers on get day. And then I would represent that as whatever language strings I wanted from that. Next thing I'm going to do is log, console log. Today is day list, which is this array. Have we talked about arrays? Everybody comfortable with arrays? Need to review arrays? Okay. An array is a set of variables. And so this is an example of a one-dimensional array. What I mean by one-dimensional is that it's simply a list of days of the week. And so I'm defining those as strings with a comma between the individual strings. And I've got an array that is 7 by 1, meaning that it is 7 days long, and there's only one element on the other dimension. So it's a one-dimensional array. I could, if I wanted to, of course, define an array that was multiple dimensions. If I declare var... I don't know. What's a good thing that that is a two-dimensional two-dimensional array? Month and day maybe. If I wanted a two-dimensional array, I'm going to call this 2D. I'll set that to. Oh, actually, I can't because I can't start a variable with a number. I can call it D2. My format for that is to have a pair of things in here. And so we'll go to January. So we better do that in quotes. February. And then we have Monday, Tuesday. Oops. Tuesday. My Italian Tuesday. So that's a 2 by 2 array at this point, where we have two dimensions in that array. Basically, it's just a way of talking about your variables in ways that you can interact with them numerically, so that you can look at the elements in the array instead of having to know the name of the variable that you're looking for. And this is really important when we start to talk about looping structures, and we'll have, for instance, the ability to use a for loop to go through all of the elements in an array. There are other ways of looping as well, but that's the key thing that being an array gives you, is the ability to iterate or loop over things in that array. Next thing that's going on here, I've done the console log. And then I call a few more functions on today. Remember, today is our data object. To get the current hours, the current minutes, and the current seconds. Then I use this fancy prepanned variable. I'm just setting the hour to AM or PM. This little deal, don't worry too much about it yet. This is an inline conditional statement. So what it means is that if this is true, then it's going to take the first of the two defined options. If this is false, it's going to take the second of the two defined options. We'll talk about other ways of doing if later, but if you see that terminology somewhere, it's essentially just an if statement. It's a shorthand form of saying if. Sorry, I left that in there. I meant to get rid of some of my conditionals in this code before I actually introduced what a conditional was, but we'll hit that in more detail in a minute. So here's the longer way of doing an if statement is if the hour is equal to zero and the it's PM, then if the minute is equal to zero and the second is equal to zero and it's 12, then it's noon. All just this little processing to make sure you say noon and midnight properly, if it actually is noon and midnight. Again, I probably ought to have dropped this out of here because it's not really relevant to this current first example. And then the main thing that I wanted out of this was that the console log, because I've gotten my hour, I've gotten the AM, PM, I've gotten my minute, and I've gotten my second, and then it outputs the console log here. Okay, I'm talking about date functions. Yep. Cool. Carrying on. There are a lot more math functions than you ever want to use in this class. Reasonable, since computers are really good at math, and that's kind of the thing that programmers tend to use in algorithms a lot of the time. At one point, computer programming was part of the math program. Then they pulled it into part of the logic program. Then eventually it became popular enough it became its own department. Really the foundation of a lot of computer science is math. And so it's not surprising that math side of the programming language is very well developed. We're only going to use very simple math in this class. You can get off and do some really off the wall things when we start talking about mapping and geography. And there's this neat thing called the Habersine formula that tells you how far a minute of latitude is at any point on Earth, and how far away things are in kilometers if you have two points represented by latitude and longitude. And so there are really neat things that we can go into all the depth on if you want to do neat calculations on this stuff in your projects. But we don't have to. We're going to use just the most basic math functions in here. Nothing that you will have had to know beyond like grade 10 math for most of the stuff we're hitting in here. So let's talk about this first one. This is a guessing game. Last term I had students build a hangman game. We've kind of skipped that exercise this time, but wanted to show you a brief example of a number guessing game. So I'm going to guess that it was number 5, and I'm going to be wrong. No, it was number 4. And then I could run it again and guess again. Doesn't really matter, though. What's going on in here is that we've got a couple functions you haven't seen before. We're creating a variable that's a number, and then this variable that's a number having a function from the math library be called that is a ceiling function. Now that ceiling function itself takes an input and it's basically going to chop off any decimal portion of a number and jump to the next number up. This is different than a round function. A round function, which is also in the math library, if you were at 10.4, it would round to 10. If you're at 10.6, it would round to 11. But the ceiling function, if you're at 10.0001, it's gonna round to 11. It's go to the next highest integer is basically what that means. And that's why when I run this, this is get a number between 1 and 10. That if my random function is going to be getting this math random, which is giving me a number between 0 and 1 and multiplying it by 10, then if that number is 0.001, it's going to be 0.1, and I still want that to be 1 because I'm looking for a number between 1 and 10. So there are a couple of important things to take away from this example. The first important thing is that you have a way of getting a random number this gets you a number between 0 and 10, and that you can operate on that number with a math operator to multiply it to turn that number into anything you want. And then additionally, that there's another math function that lets you chop that to the ceiling. Other one to know is that you can chain functions. Does that make sense? That I'm calling the random function, I'm multiplying that random function by 10, and I'm calling the ceiling function all in one line of code. And basically by just wrapping them the way that I have, the operations here happen in sequence, that I resolve everything that's inside that ceiling function before I call the ceiling function, and then I assign the results of that ceiling function to the var num. We're gonna use that a lot. Next thing we haven't seen before is this alert. And so my gnum is just a variable that's declared to take the string, guess the number between 1 and 10 inclusive. I'm going to prompt and ask for that number. A prompt is a built-in function that asks for an input, basically. And so it's going to ask for that input and then assign it to the variable genome. And let's actually spit that out just to get a better idea of what I just said there. Let's run that and open up our developer console. Okay, so it spit out 5. That was the thing that genome was, which was the number that I guessed. And so we have 2 new statements in here you'll use a lot in your code, at least for this type of application, which is prompt and alert. And the prompt is asking for an input. It's an input box that takes it and assigns it to any variable. And alert is something that posts up a message box but doesn't let you input anything. So you can just say okay on things. So both of these are really important ways to kind of pop out of the page to ask the user a question. But the main thing on this page I wanted to focus on were the math functions. And if you want the full list of math functions, of course, go back to Mozilla Developer Network and you can go through and see all sorts of fun things about this. You can get E and lons and logs and pi and square roots and absolute values and cosines and sines and, you know, the whole list of things that you might ever want on creating equations. Isn't that exciting? Sorry. Let's talk about strings. Strings are a lot more exciting. I like strings. Words are good. Basically, what you want to do with strings is think of them as sets of characters. And so here I talk about arrays. Remember when I was saying arrays are simply lists of variables? You can think of a string as being an array of characters. So let's take the string cat. So if I say var, that's the keyword to declare a variable, animal, equals quote cat, end quote. Then what I'm saying is I'm creating a variable that takes the string cat. What that actually is an array of characters. So I have animal equals character number 1 is C, character number 2 is A, character number 3 is T. Or actually more correctly, because this will become important as you iterate over things, character number 0 is C, 1 is A, and 2 is T. Everything is zero indexed in the array that we use here. Okay? So don't forget to look at index number 0 on these arrays. But think of strings as basically being arrays of characters. And so that's important in looking at things that operate on strings. Let's look at another example here, which is a kind of slick little a way of making a string loop. You see my W3 resource over here on the right-hand side is flicking through and doing this marquee effect of stepping through over time through those letters. The way that I'm doing that is by using a variety of string functions in here. And there are a couple other things that I'm doing as well. I want to note that this is the first time that I'm doing a load type of in head for my code here. And the reason I'm doing that is that I have my body doing an on load. So as soon as the body is loading, it's loading this animate string. And so if my JavaScript was declared in the body, then when the body was loaded, the JavaScript wouldn't have been declared and it wouldn't be able to call that. So if I load it in the head, because the head loads before the body, then I'm able to call body on load, and as soon as the body is loading, it's able to call that that function in there. And the reason I want to do that is because you'll notice that my string is still looping over here on the right-hand side, that I didn't want to have to push a button to start it looping or something. Yeah, I could have done it that way. I could have, instead of doing this, let's kill my body on load. And instead in here, put a button and put my button, and it's no longer on load, it's on click. Animate string target. And then we'll just say loop and close my button. Oops. And then if I run that one, it won't start looping until I press loop, and then it will start looping. But because I wanted it to start looping immediately without a button there, I put it on that on load message, then it had to have all this declared in the head rather than the body. Notice something else, that once I put the button in the body, I can still reference things that are declared in the head, that it doesn't actually matter where that function is declared, as long as it's declared before I try and use it. The other thing I've done in this is that I'm actually passing it in this target. And that target is the ID of the target. And then the first thing I'm doing is declaring this variable text and getting the inner HTML. Remember, that inner HTML is the text of the target. And that's what I'm operating on in this particular function. So this is actually a fairly packed together little function talking about string manipulation. I haven't even gotten to the string manipulation part. Are there any parts of kind of the outer wrapping of this function that people are finding confusing? No? Okay. Good. So let's talk about the string pieces on this. I've gotten the text of that W3 resource, and let's just turn it into something simpler for a second and call it cat. And loop my cat message. I guess it's cat space, actually. I've got a space after it. And then inside this next bit, I'm calling set interval. Set interval is a special function in JavaScript that basically says run this thing over and over. So this variable right at the end, or this number right at the end in red here, is the interval at which this function is going to run. In this case, 500 milliseconds. If I were to set this to, 50 milliseconds and run this, we would see the cat run really quickly. If I set it to 2,000, cat's going to run really slowly. Basically, that set interval is not at all, because I set it. Oh, there we go. That interval is when it's going to run this on a repeated basis. And remember a minute ago we looked at ceiling that had random inside of it? Essentially, this is exactly the same thing, we're calling this function that is declared inside set interval, and that sets it up to be called every 2 seconds in this case. And what's actually going on inside that set interval function are the text manipulations. This whole example was all about strings, honestly. I'm talking about all these other things, but really it's to get to the point of doing string manipulations, and there's just this window dressing around it. So remember, text is this variable that has a string in it. The string in this case is cat space. And what I'm doing with that is I'm saying, treating it like an array again, that I'm going to take the item that is text length minus one. So text length here, let's actually look at that. Console.log text.length. And we'll run this and open up my developer console. Oh, come on. Oh, of course, it's not going to run that until I press loop. So text length is 4 here. So 4 minus 1 is going to be 3. Remember, we're 0 indexed, if I want the last item that's in there, I refer to that as element 3 of the text string. Does that make sense? That because 0, 1, 2, 3, 3 is the fourth item in the string cat space. So I'm saying take the last entry in that array of characters that is the string we're operating on and put that first in this variable called text. And then take the substring of the first item to the last item and put that in the variable. So you're basically taking the last item, shoving it in the first item. Now, of course, the thing is has moved, so the length in the last item is a different last item, and so then you're putting that afterwards. You'll often use this in different strings. Operating on a string itself in place is a fairly unusual case. I wanted to put this example to show that it's possible. But the main thing I want you to focus on are the two functions that are in here. Text.length, which tells you the length of a string that you're operating on, and this substring function that allows you to grab any arbitrary number of characters from within that string. And these two things together let you do all sorts of text manipulations on a guess string basis. It's actually grabbing the characters from 0 to the length minus 1. And yeah, exactly. So let's actually break this out to a couple of different steps and then spit that out so we can see what it's grabbing. X equals
6 plus. That should still do what I want it to do.
Oh, no, it's not. It's going to die horribly. Why is it going to die horribly? Because I haven't closed that. Then I'm going to change this to be fast again so I don't have to wait for it to do its thing. No, it's still going to die horribly. Let's see. Let's do something a little bit different here to make that unpacked. Var text one, I won't be as fancy. Yeah. Declare that to an empty string. I will say text one equals text. That will give me that. Let me actually use a couple of variables. The logic of my silly little statement here is actually not as clear as I would like. That. Okay, so we're running again, and now I wanted to use that as an example to be able to spit out console.log text one colon space text one. You can see that's always the last letter that's in there. And if we look at a console.log of text 2, incidentally, as I'm doing this, I want you to notice another thing, that I am able to operate on strings as if they were numbers and that we're using the plus sign to concatenate them. There are explicit string concatenation functions, but I don't need to use them. I can just use plus and minus to pull things on and off. I don't know if that makes any clearer what was actually happening in there, but it at least makes it different. I'm going to update that as number 2, by the way. If anybody in the slides wants to play with that one a little bit more, it's in there as 2. Questions or thoughts about string manipulation? Okay. Last thing we're going to talk about in terms of programming statements tonight is this idea of control flow. And we've looked at a couple of examples of control flow tonight already. It's one that can get really complex. In some sense, functions are a version of control flow. We'll talk about recursion later on in the class. That's a kind of nested inside itself version of control flow. But here I really want to talk about the simplest examples. So we looked at set interval. That's a version of control flow. It just means that every X milliseconds, you're going to rerun the function that was being run. and it's going to interrupt whatever else was going on there. So that's a version of control flow. But most control flow expressions test a variable rather than time. And so this is things like the for loop. This looks at the state of a counter variable. We've looked at if a couple times. If then else is a structure for testing an explicit condition and then branching based on that condition. And so let's look at a couple of these in a fiddle example. And I better open my console log again. Clear this. And then we'll run this. So what this is doing this for loop is saying for variable x, we're declaring the variable in line to that for loop. And one of the things to note, because we're declaring it in line with the for loop, is that its block scope to this for loop, we couldn't access that x variable anywhere outside the for loop. There isn't anywhere outside in this particular program, but scoping is the lowest level to which it's declared. But we're declaring counter variable x starts at 0, that it will continue while x is less than or equal to 15, and that at each loop, it will add 1 to x. That's what the three parts of a for loop say. The counter variable and what it starts at, the counter variable and what it ends at, and the way that you increment that counter variable. And what we're doing inside there is saying if x equals 0, then it's even. Else if, which is saying if it's not equal to 0, if it's something other than 0, if x modulo 2, everybody familiar with the modulo operator? Modulo operator is what's left over after you divide. If I were to x modulo 2 and x was it was 1, it would be 1 divided by 2, which is not equal to 0. 3 divided by 2 is 1.5, and so there's a leftover after the division. And that modulo operator gives you that leftover. So if that leftover is not exactly equal to 0, then you must be an odd number. So say, or if it is equal to 0, you must be an even number. So we'll say else if it's equal to 0, then you're an even number. And then else, in every other case, you're an odd number. And so the way that this if expression works is that if any one of these three expressions matches, it drops out of the if expression. So if you're equal to 0, you're an even number because 0 is even. If your modulo 2 is equal to 0, then you're an even number. If your modulo 2 is not equal, or if anything else, then you're an odd number. So there are a couple things I'd like to play with on this. The first thing I'd like to play with is the way that this for loop is set up. Let's go ahead and call that x plus 3. Any ideas what this is going to give me? Actually, let's make it easier. Let's say x plus 2. Am I going to get any odd numbers? I'm not going to get any odd numbers. Apparently, I'm not going to get any numbers at all. Oh, why am I waiting for... Oh, I know what happened here. Who can tell me what happened? This is actually a programming flaw you're going to hit at some point. I'm going by twos, and my watch condition is 15. So I'm skipping right over my watch condition. Hence, I hit 573 even numbers here, and bad things start to happen, and I've hung my fiddle. Huh. Okay, come back here, fiddle. Okay. Don't come back here, fiddle. My fiddle's done bad things to me. Oh, sigh. It is, actually. Yeah. Okay, bad fiddle. Stop. Stop, stop, stop. Go away. No, you won't go away, will you? Huh.
let's ignore that and reopen my silly thing into another fiddle, and eventually that page will decide to die, I hope. I know my fiddle is an unsafe draft. It's a dangerous one. Okay, anyway, that's how that guy is working. Be careful of end conditions, I guess, is the object lesson of that one. Make sure that actually the way you're incrementing will get you to your end conditions, and that all that is correct. The other thing in here is the equal sign. There are actually two different equals, three different equals in JavaScript. It's worth talking about these for a minute. The first type of equals is a single equal. You've seen me use that in a number of places in here. When I was doing when I was setting my counter initially equals to 0 or equal to 10, that's the first style of equals. A single equal sign in JavaScript means I want to set something. I'm setting my variable equal to 0 or equal to 10. It's doing an assignment. Then there's two equal signs. Two equal signs is doing a loose comparison, it's called. See if we can set up a situation where a loose comparison can work, but a strong comparison cannot. I'm just going to start a new one here. And let's say var str equals 0, and we're going to say var num equals 0, and we're going to say if str equals num, then console.log, it worked. Do we expect this to match with two equal signs? It's a string 0 versus a number 0. Yes, we do. So then we bring ourselves to the three equal signs, which is what we saw in that picture a whole lot. What three equal signs means is this is an exact match. It's the same type of variable. Everything about it is the same. Let's say else console.log. Nope. And so three equal signs will not match a string 0 to a number 0. This is important because if you are trying to do conversions from strings to numbers, it means you have to use another one of those math functions. Which makes it into a number before you can operate on it like a number. But in a lot of cases, if you're only using two equals, it means you can loosely operate on it to see if they're equivalent. You're going to find yourself in some of the situations wanting to either be more lax or more rigorous about that based on what your user is trying to type in. One of the ones that won't come up this week, we're going to do a homework exercise this week that doesn't require typed input to be parsed. But I believe next week we'll do the typed input parsing exercise. And you're going to want to use the exact equals on that one to make sure your user is not typing in anything other than numbers when they're entering numbers into the exercise. So just keep two versus that three equal signs in mind in terms of loose match versus tight match. So that has actually brought us another hour in here. I wanted to have you guys work on a couple of examples out of these to work out situations that I may have covered briefly that you don't quite understand. Let's take 10 minutes for you to find puzzlers out of this on me, take a break, and then we'll come back, talk about the project, and then I'm going to give you a bit more challenging homework than I have, and so I'll give you the first or another half hour, last half hour or so of class to work on that so you can ask me questions about it.
Let's take 10 minutes before we do that, anyway, so. Of course, if I break it the same way, I might not be able to show any code again, but I bet we can get this figured out. Okay. I have broken it in the same way. So I follow you down the path to destruction anyways. Yeah, I sure have. Let's see. That's not gonna do it. That's not gonna do it. Huh. Oh, geez. Sorry, I've broken myself in interesting ways. I'm going to be a couple minutes.
Oh. We've gotten to that, however, after Nathan watches.
I usually throw one of the drivers or something in there. Huh, now it saved that one. I shouldn't have followed you down this path. Going to severely hamper my ability to do that.
Thank you.
Thanks. Truly a pain that closes so early and locks. It is. Huh. No, I seem to have followed you down the path to destruction and can't get my window sizes back. This is going to quite limit my ability to do much with this. So, let's see. Completely closing. Huh. Okay, cool.
I do have a solution for
you. If you open up your developer tools and go to
Now, so you still have another browser window open, but let's go back to that. Okay. And now I'll close every one of your brushes. Let's go to one more time. So my next step is going to be to have to do that, to read all of those, and actually carry it. Is Chrome still running in the background somewhere? That's what's being here. Oh, yes, yes, yes. So let's go back through that first as we're closing. Chrome, maybe let's just. That was just right. Yes, good deal. Excellent. Yeah.
Yeah, hold on. I'm going to come right back to that for a second.
That's normal. Yeah, yeah. I was looking at it on its own. That is my new thing. Git talking. But that's pretty cool enough today. Are you thinking server than all? Are you thinking server other than home and reading that? I wouldn't have said it still. I would have expected it would have done something, but for his IP. Yeah. Well, you lost all your dirt.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah. Just to leave it on you to hear what we're talking about with Kodak, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay.
There we go.
Let's launch back into a couple things and then talk about project two and the homework. And then I'll give you guys a chance to start on the homework since I think you might need a little bit of help on this one. And the more we can do tonight, the less we have to try and do via the Slack group. So talking about project two, this one is a bit different than project one. I want you to run on your project one ideas, but basically this is all about execution. And so, in project one, we were wanting a presentation to kind of sell an idea, to sell a website design, and then to set the business justification. In some sense, I don't actually care what it is you're developing this time through. I want a well-executed website, and if you deviate some from the plan that you outlined in project one, that's just fine. Things are going to deviate over time, and it's just kind of expected. There's going to be a presentation associated with project two, but it's going to be really, really minimal as compared to project one. Really for project two, I want to see what it is that you've created. And your presentation is going to be capped at 3 minutes per group. So really short and sweet, just showing what it is you built, giving a quick run through. And I've got that gong and that hook cane, and we'll be yanking off after 3 minutes. We will have a couple of minutes for questions. I want the questions to really be focused around wow, that was cool. How do you do that to spark more development discussion? So there will be a couple minutes for questions in there. But for the presentation itself, I want to be really hard and fast, sticking to 3 minutes. Goal on this one is to give what's called an elevator pitch. When I've got a piece of software that I'm working on run into somebody, I've really got 3 minutes, or really only about 1 minute for a true elevator pitch, but I want to give you guys a bit of a break and give you a bit more time to not compress this. Give the quick and dirty version of what it is I'm working on and show why it's so cool. So this is a slightly longer elevator pitch, and you can actually use a display to show what you're working on, but it should get it really concise as to what we've built, why it's cool, and what it does for the user. So showing the website is part of that. Nothing needs to work, though. On this one, I don't want you to have a database tied into the back end. I don't want you to have any actual math in there. I don't want you to have any actual behaviors, unless they're pure front-end behaviors. It needs to be responsive and styled properly, though. So whereas last time in Project One, could just draw a sketch on a piece of paper of your website, here I actually want it to be on a web page and want you actually to be on a web server and pointing to that web server. And what's more, it's going to be from my computer opening the website, so it must be on one of your web servers that are for the class here so that I can actually just point to it. Now, you only need one for your group, so don't feel like you have to copy to all of your web servers in the class. Just one web server has to be designated as your group web server. In terms of the grading on this guy, first 4 points are for being properly hosted and checked into GitHub. What this means is that I can open the page from my computer, it looks right, that links work, and the code is all checked in. If you're actually populating your web server from your GitHub and it works, you've got those first 4 points easy. The next 3 points here are for showing a proper GitHub history. What I mean by this is that if you only have one check-in and that's your entire site, and it means you've been working independently and putting files together outside of GitHub, you're doing it wrong. This is not the way to collaborate on a website. So I want to actually see that all the members are checking things in, that people are checking little bits with good commit messages, so it's actually trackable as a good working project. This is kind of just in working in a group, the way to work with GitHub to make sure that everybody's accountable for what it is that they're putting in on this. 5 points are for the well-designed and responsive styling of the page. Using your own CSS, using Bootstrap, using UIKit, I don't care what you use, but this thing has to be responsive, meaning you scale it up and down and it flows nicely, that it looks okay on reasonably small screens or great big screens. Yeah. Absolutely. Use whatever templates you want to start with. Use whichever styling kit you want. Make sure that it actually looks the way kind of you want it to look, and that it's a well-designed working front end of the website. And then finally, the last 3 points in here are for JavaScript and behaviors leading to effective interaction. This doesn't mean you have to tie to backends. If you have, for instance, a drop-down list that would normally populate from a database to list all the summer camps that were in the database. You have to just have a variable in your JavaScript that has an array of camps in there, and that's what populates your drop-down. So it's having enough in there in the JavaScript to actually simulate the interactions you want to have on your full website. That we don't care what we're talking to, we just care how it looks to the users. We can look at the user interaction. So that's kind of how things work on Project 2. Feel free to do a little bit of group swapping around if you want to, make sure you do that this week so you have time to work on this. Let me know if there's any group swapping around happening. It's probably easiest to stick with the groups you got, if there's something that really needs to change, then just please let me know early on that. This is where I actually get hard and fast. We had a couple people who kind of slipped in and didn't find a group and stuff. And the first time around, I gave them a bit of a break on that. You really need to work on this as a group. This is too big for one person to do on their own. And really part of the project is the group interaction and making sure you're using GitHub as a group properly. So make sure you're keeping your groups and really do work properly as a group on this. Any Project 2 questions? I should have put this on here. I had it on the syllabus and then didn't think to move it here. I believe 2 weeks. I believe this is week 5. No, it's due on week 8. Not next week, not the following week, but the one after that. I don't remember when spring break is in here as well. Let me actually pull up the... then we may be one more week beyond that even. Let me pull up the syllabus actually and see when that is due. Thanks for asking that question. March 1st. Yeah, so we've got a little bit of time yet. 1, 2, 3, 4 weeks.
Oh, wait.
What's that? The week of the 15th is reading week? Okay, cool. Good to know. Anyways, March 1st is the due date on Project 2. And intentionally out there a little ways because it is going to take some work to get this done. I'd really encourage starting early on this one. If you start late and get stuck on something, I'm probably not going to be able to help the last week in rescuing from a hole. But if you get caught in a hole this next week or two, I can probably find ways of helping to drag you out of that hole. So start early, hit it hard, make sure you're in good shape on it. Yeah. So homework 5. This is going to be the start of a multi-week project on homeworks. We're going to build on each other a little bit. The goal here is really to start getting you to the point where you're building more complex websites iteratively, building on what you've built previously. So this first week is actually a fairly simple start into it, but you have some behaviors you have to start putting on there. So this means that we will be integrating CSS, JS, and HTML into something that will grow into a functional pizza ordering website. I'm going to flip to the next page and then back to this for a minute, and this is my horrible chicken scratching, is a website that allows you to order pizzas. And so you might have a basic pizza that's $10. You might have a pepperoni a topping that's $2. You might have a mushroom topping that's $3. Each of these are to be buttons. When you press the button, it updates the total and presses the total down here at the bottom of the page. If you hit clear, it goes back to zero. It goes back to zero, and you can go back to adding pizza items. So I don't need these to be drawn out of a database. I don't need these to be drawn out of a list even. These can just be hard-coded. And what you have to have in there is the image tag to show images, and I want the images to be checked into your GitHub repository. You have to have buttons that call JavaScript, and a function for each one of these is probably the way that I would tend to do it. We can make it more efficient later to call all the toppings under the same function. You have to have JavaScript that adds a running total and shows that total on the page here. So use the inner HTML to display up on the page. A clear button that zeroes the total and updates inner HTML again with the zero there. And then a point for nice styling. And if you use Bootstrap or something, you get extra cheers and pats on the back. But make it look good, because this is going to be going through a couple weeks of homeworks here anyways. Sound overwhelming? You do. So image and the image tag has an SRC equals attribute the same way a script does. And if it's in the same directory, you don't need to give it a path or anything. And that's why I'm saying you check it all into your project. Okay. So this is a bit bigger one than the past weeks. And you have a bit more leeway on how you do it. A lot of help on the Slack group, and it's one y'all I'm sure can all get done. If you want, though, let's take the rest of the class here to begin working on it. Make sure you have a structure to work on, so I can help you in person a little bit easier than over Slack. And if you do have a midterm or something, please feel free to take off and do this afterwards if you're convinced you can do it. But we've got a half hour or so to actually get in person help on it if you want to work on it.
And there's so much bubble.
So you had him Thank you.
mean, you don't have to write into the database. You don't have to. It doesn't mean. Some applications might have only one page, but it might be a great one. In general. Hey. Go back for this. Yep. Okay, so you are not in a repository. So now you're not, you don't ever want to be in there. The other bag is, you can see my hand. Okay, now do it again. Great. So you see how you are pretty strong. Did you delete your bumper? I usually have a great big room that I was there that I got. I think that I was taking the part of the room and I only did it for the month from here. I attended the part of the room. How was it for we're going to pop out of this directory. Yeah, you'll see these things about that. And we're going to keep everything from the one that back into this directory. So thank you. You will need so what this is saying is move everything from that directory to that directory to the same name in this what we have anyway is a new repository.
That's a good set. So your head of origin, that's what I want. Yeah, okay, great. So now if you refresh the observer again, they call your files from there. And so now you go up to the web server and load the stuff off. And then the SSH, you know what you're doing. When you get past that, the SSH instruction chart last week, you know, it was very bad. It was not a good place. Yeah, okay. So probably, yeah, let's try that. Let me watch the video and Yeah, that means you probably were
It gets confusing, doesn't it?
Thank you.
Yeah, you bet. Okay, free guys. Okay, let's just take a page on the
Okay, great. So you are on your server. Now, you have LX, so you can see what it is. And public HTML is the root of all your queries. Okay, now here what you're going to do is clone the things from your repository. So if you still go back and copy the content repository, and that is here, say, get clone. So copy everything that the server into there, and you should now be able to. In a browser that wants to and you have a CSS3 if you don't. All right, well, we will talk on Slack.
Yes.
All right, have a good weekend.
Bye, thank you, Christian.
Take care. Well, I don't know that it's going to do this without the comments. I haven't located that comment. Let's go back onto your server and tell over here that this is securing the CP titled.
I'm not going to see how much one.
Awesome. Good burger. Okay.
So it is the fact that you need to have following assessments, and so and so I would go ahead and modify the in your directory to the same thing we just did by doing a git add, git commit, git push, and git pull back into your server. These are the steps that are on page 40 in the cube, and then starting to keep that page. But you got something up there, which is good. Good start.
How do you want it? Yeah,
that's
fine.
Well, how many will help you, Nate? I mean, it's, I'm not... We'll get on the Slack and send a note and let me help as well. Let me know if you want to.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyway, I'm going to go over and just go on and help him. Or you can send me his name.
I did.
And I said, I bet you can get things like I'm happy to kind of figure out what the last week to get from Slack.
Gotcha, okay.
Yeah. So I'll do that. I'll do that tomorrow.
No, I understand this problem as well. I do too. I recognize that one. Well, if it if you get to the point where you're talking with Samantha about some of this, and it may make